Rockefeller Mansion is a monument to the American dream because it's owned by someone who beat all the odds. Dr. Marnie Bhaumik was born into crushing poverty in the barren backlands of India. But in 1959, he won a scholarship to America. He beamed a fabulous fortune as a laser whiz and never looked back.
I was born in a mud hut, thatched roof, and slept on the rags with my grandmother. And we were poor, but I didn't know the difference because I didn't know anything better.
With more than a dozen patents in laser technology under his belt, the UCLA doctor designed his own Taj Mahal, right in Bel Air, California. From Corinthian columns to plantation verandas, he borrowed from every style in 2 years of around-the-world research. Greco to Deco, Roman to Georgian, the eclectic fusion merrily plays French and Italian antiques off 24-karat gold fixtures. Construction took another 2 years, with the good doctor overseeing every step. The finishing touch? Strauss crystal chandeliers. The result? One man's pride and joy.
There are very few houses which we call neoclassical, and the proportions has to be exactly right. Many things you had to do it two or three times before it came out right.
This is the land of opportunity, and the greatest incentive to succeed here is to be in no doubt of that fact.
So American dream is truly alive and well, and I think I'm a living proof.
Old saying that a man's home is his castle, but few people really live in a castle. There's also an old American axiom about pulling oneself up by his own bootstraps, and in reality, not many of us do that either. But there are those who have driven themselves to success and bought themselves a castle as a reward. And they are some of America's greatest citizens. Such is the success story of Dr. Marnie Bhaumik. And while some may call his home a castle, in reality, it's his personal model of Le Petit Trianon in the famed gardens of Versailles. Arriving at the estate in his classic Rolls Royce, Dr. Bhaumik sometimes marvels at how his life is progressing. He has always had an insatiable desire to succeed, but no one knew it would come this far. Dr. Bhaumik was born into poverty. Malnutrition from famine took his grandmother's life when he was a young child. Later, he studied in Calcutta and began his quest for success. A PhD in physics brought him to America and the beginning of his personal dream. A career full of scientific successes allowed him to take off his white lab jacket, and it put him in a conservative business suit to begin planning his neoclassical dream house, where the rich and famous live in the rolling Bel Air Hills. Taste and elegance is carefully planned in each room. Dr. Bhaumik personally selected the 8,000 square feet of marble in the entry hall. It came from the same Italian quarry where Michelangelo carved marble blocks for his sculptures. And every room has Louis XIV furnishings. Hollywood has found the mansion, a staircase has been the backdrop for many perfume commercials.
This is the dawn of Glorious. Glorious, the joyous new fragrance by Gloria Vanderbilt. Bursting with a promise of things to come. Enter the world of Glorious by Gloria Vanderbilt, and may all your days be glorious.
More fun than spending lots and lots of money. Winning lots and lots of money, darlings. $10 million. Phew! That's what Publishers Clearing House is giving away to one lucky person. Just watch for this envelope. You see the little house? I may be your lady luck, but you could be the one who's having all the fun. Just enter and remember, you're the lucky one at Publishers Clearing House. What am I doing here in all these bubbles? Working, darlings, working. My job is to show you how lovely life could be if you win the $10 million in Publishers Clearing House sweepstakes. You just look for this envelope. See the little house? Listen to your lady luck. You enter, darlings, and you could get a job like this. You're really the lucky one at Publishers Clearing House.
End of a fulfilling day, Dr. Bhaumik has time to stroll the impressive grounds and literally smell the roses. It's not what you would expect from an eminently famous scientist, because most scientists rarely have a chance to enjoy the life made possible by scientific achievements. On this day, the halls of the mansion are quiet. But quite often, they are filled with the voices of guests that have been invited with open arms. And that, too, is incongruous, because many wealthy people prefer not to share their private lives with outsiders. Perhaps because Dr. Bhaumik shared his scientific achievements with society, he is able to share other aspects of his life as well. And often, it's the comfortable setting of a lecture, a social gathering, or even a party.
So I would say that that is a very important place to begin. And some people have spoken here of the Center for Partnership Studies and the Partnership Society. That's one of the things, partnership process is one of the things that we hope to really help to integrate and to work with.
You know, the Japanese corporation have shown very nicely that cooperation rather than the confrontation leads to most success, and that's why they have been successful. I think that is the biggest difference between the corporation in this country, in Japan, and undoubtedly they have succeeded in cooperating rather than confronting between management and the worker, as well as between the corporations. They have more cooperation than confrontation as opposed to us, and that's probably one of the things we have to change in our corporation for survival.
I don't believe there is any education going on anywhere in the Western world. We need to supplant what we're doing with children, who are the most wonderful of all creatures, and who are literally telling you what needs to be done. Encourage my need to love by being loved. and give me the opportunities for wonder, for experimental mindedness, for explorativeness, for creativity, for imaginativeness, and so on. If we would do this, we would produce healthy human beings, and we would solve, in my view, virtually every one of the problems which we are facing.
Mm-hmm. I'm so glad that you are so optimistic, finally, because we had some pessimistic discussion before. And especially in terms of genes, I'd like to ask you a question. You know, every DNA molecule in our body, which every cell carries, is programmed for survival. Since you have placed so much emphasis on genes in terms of determining our behavior, don't you think that is very good insurance for our survival? That every molecule, every DNA molecule in our
system. Absolutely, those are a complete cooperative system. Yet this system is seen as competitive. And there's one man called Richard Dawkins at Oxford who has published a book called The Selfish Gene, which believes that genes are in competition with each other. This is an idea that was published originally in 1888 by Wilhelm Ruhl, the founder of ROUS.
But from every point of view, and incidentally, there are biologists today who are coming around to this view, that it, in spite of Darwin's great genius, the wonderful and gentle man he was, he didn't see sufficiently that cooperation was the rule and not competition.
The mansion is also used for entertaining. Dr. Bhaumik is a host, always willing to open his home for the enjoyment of others.
Distinguished guests and friends, a very wonderful welcome to you to this wonderful evening, a gala evening, not only because we are celebrating the Independence Day of India, also we are celebrating the birthday of Governor Joe McCarthy, and also in a way it's a kind of a special day for me because it's a day that a dream came true. When I came to UCLA many years ago from India, the area that we're here now, the lower Bel Air area, north of Sunset, was forbidden country to the students because one could only dream of having a house here. And now, today, like many of you, to my pleasant surprise, I realized that American dream is well and alive. And I'm happy in a very special way to welcome you here and share my home, my dream home, with you on this very happy occasion. And welcome to you all again. And I hope, sincerely hope, that all of you have a very wonderful time. Thank you.
Tonight you'll meet one of the hottest stars on daytime TV from Days of Our Lives. He's Charles Shaughnessy. You'll be entertained by the latest musical success from Elton John. It's called A Word in Spanish. And you'll find out how one scientist who was born into poverty became a self-made millionaire. It's all coming up next on Success Stories. My next guest is a physicist from India who was born into poverty, but today leads the life of a multimillionaire. His inventions involving lasers have improved radar as well as communications underwater and in outer space. We're going to find out more about that when we meet Dr. Manny Bhaumik. Hello and welcome to Success Stories.
Hello.
Now, I understand you grew up in a small village in India. For us Americans who have no idea what this is like, could you give us a little idea, a description?
Yes, I'll try. It's really quite different from what you see here. The best way I can describe it is that almost going back to Jesus' time. In fact, if I told you today that I have discovered a time machine, how would you like to go back to Jesus' time? You obviously wouldn't believe me. Mm-hmm. But in fact, you can get in a plane and go to the village and see the fossilized life that is reminiscent of Jesus' time. And those people are not really acting, they're living that life because that's their life. Mm-hmm. And
so no modern appliances?
Very little.
No electricity?
Only recently it is seeping through, but mm-hmm. their life, way of life has not changed very much.
Very much.
You can see transistor radios and once in a while, uh-huh. but it hasn't changed their way of life at all.
Mm-hmm. And what did your father do for a living?
He was a school teacher, mm-hmm. Supporting a family of 10.
So at least he valued education.
Yes, mm-hmm. but he was only making about $5 a month.
Oh no!
Supporting a family of 10. But. There, of course, we grew our own food and vegetable, mm-hmm. and for the other things, that $5 a month went, at least, we didn't know you're poor, uh-huh. because you don't know, when you have nothing to compare, you don't know you're poor.
You don't know, I guess you're right. But I understand that you were very fortunate in that you were kind of spoiled, one of the most loved children in the family.
Well, I would say I was spoiled. I certainly was loved very much. My grandmother was the matriarch of the family, and she wanted to have a grandchild very much. And in the family of 10, there was no children. And so much so that she threatened my mother that if she didn't have a child soon, that she'll have the marriage annulled.
Could she do that?
Yes, because she didn't like something that the wife and the children of my one of my uncle's wife did, and she was thrown out of the family.
Wow.
And
she so it was a very happy day when you arrived
for my mother, thanks to saving her marriage, as well as my grandmother. In fact, my grandmother monopolized me from my mother. So much so that I only later on realized my grandmother wasn't my real mother.
Yeah.
And I was around her neck all the time, and she used to call me her necklace. And so was in the family. Rest of them wanted to have me in their lap. So I was never left alone. And that's a lot of love to have, almost to last a lifetime. And I have learned from psychologists later on that that love is really very important during the formative stage of a child, a genuine
true
love.
It may have helped you.
Very much so.
Advance.
That
mm-hmm.
gave me the impetus to break the cycle of poverty that was born. And as you know, it's very hard to break the cycle of poverty. You feel like you're trapped in a black hole. Mm-hmm. But that impetus really propelled me through mm-hmm. to break the cycle of poverty.
Mm-hmm. In fact, you were telling me before the show that your grandmother made the ultimate sacrifice for love.
Yes, as cruel she seemed from the fact that she could have thrown my mother out, at the same time she made an ultimate sacrifice a human being can do for love. During a famine in 1942 following a cyclone, there was very little food around because India was under colonialism. There was no relief effort. War was going on. So a lot of people were starving. And my grandmother, bless her heart, she gave me her food, said, here, you need it more than I do. and she died of malnutrition.
Wow, it's really incredible. It's so many Americans just don't realize how much we have, you know, until maybe we hear stories of your life. But it was through education that you were able to go to college and eventually come to America to study, right?
Yes, and education is something that was important, and that thought was instilled into me by my father, who was a school teacher, of course.
But when you arrived here in America, what did you think?
Oh, it was a total cultural shock.
Uh-huh.
And I thought I've died and gone to heaven, because everything was just like what you would imagine to be in heaven, the standard of living, and the weather, of course, in California. Mm-hmm. But more so that here I was able to exchange my views with other people, more so than in India. Here, really, I found not only...
They frowned upon that. You weren't allowed to speak openly about things.
Well, you can speak, but they will think you're a lunatic.
Uh-huh.
But so you know, if you what's good for you, you don't
say anything. Yeah, isn't that interesting? And then it was here at UCLA that you started working on lasers.
No, actually, when I came in 1959, lasers have not been discovered yet. Mm-hmm. I was doing my graduate work, and lasers were discovered in 1960, and that's when they needed a lot of scientists in that new field, and my background fitted very nicely. So I was able to stay because of that, actually. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, I'd have to go back.
Mm-hmm. And to explain to our audience in lay terms, what exactly have your inventions been able to do? What are some of their applications?
Well, being a scientist, I was more involved in improving the lasers, their efficiencies, their power, their different colors. Of course, always with an application in mind. And I was fortunate to be involved in discovering a new class of lasers called excimer lasers. Examples are xenon chloride, krypton fluoride, and those have applications in many fields. The name a few. They are being developed for radar for a long distance, especially for space, mm-hmm. part of Star Wars, for example. And it has been shown to be able to communicate underwater. As you know, radio waves do not go through the water, so submarines are not able to communicate unless they come to surface, and that's real.
Uh-huh.
And no for them, because they're sitting ducks and they're on the surface. And with this laser beam, with another technique we call Raman technique, that you can communicate to the submarines, those are being developed now. And also recently, some of those lasers have been used to remove plaque from arteries, and not in humans yet. But it's beginning to look very promising.
Now, but you worked for companies at this time, and they actually, do they actually own the patents?
Yes, because that's the way
it is.
They provide the money.
If you work for the company, yes. Then you, and did they give you any kind of bonus for having achieved this?
Yes, I was very fortunate to have stock options in both Xerox and Northrop where I worked.
Mm-hmm.
And that was... something that gave me seed money.
Mm-hmm. But it wasn't the inventions that enabled you to make your money now, right?
That's right.
Which is so typical of scientists, right? Very few scientists are very, very wealthy, right?
Very, very few. In fact, I always talk to people as my favorite peeve, so to speak, that scientists who actually were the originator of ideas that gave us the affluence today very seldom gets to enjoy that affluence.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to make sure that doesn't happen to me.
Yeah.
But that didn't happen through science. But with the stock options that were given in the companies that gave me the seed money, which I invest in various things, but California real estate is what made me financially independent,
mm-hmm.
Beyond my wildest dream.
Mm-hmm. And today you're a retired scientist who deals with a lot of humanitarian causes.
Yes.
One of them is the homeless, and I was just curious if you could just briefly tell us, you know, What could we do to help the homeless?
Well, as I mentioned to you before, that in India, we're practically homeless, slept on the rag and a thatched roof house. Right. But it didn't bother me there because nobody was any better off. But when you come and see here, in the richest country in the world, we have people on the street, that is really inconceivable. And to me, it is not really a matter of money, because the amount of money that is required to solve that problem is minuscule compared to the social welfare money that we already spend. Mm-hmm. I think it's a recognition of the problem that those people practically given up, and they have no hope, almost trapped in a black hole. And so they're really more of a social work help and than anything else, to give them hope that it is possible.
Well, continued success, and thank you for all your good work. We appreciate your coming today.
Thank you very much.